All right, let's see where God leads us today. You know, every year that Christmas rolls around, we can all talk and we can tell stories, and things get crazy, whether we're doing Christmas shopping, whether we got parties we go to, family gathers, all of a sudden we're pulling our hair out, and sometimes it's just nice to sit down, take a breath, and just think about what Christmas is. Memories, you know, Christmas memories is what we're going to focus on today, but let's all stand together. Our verses today, we're going to just have two simple verses. If you want to turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. And if you'll turn your Bibles there, let's take and read God's Word together and prepare our hearts. So, okay, like I said, verse 17. When they had seen this, they made known the statement which had been told them about this child. And all who heard it wondered at the things which were told them by the shepherds. So today our title is going to be All Who Heard. You know, you can be seated. And let's see how God touches our hearts. Like I said, you know, Christmas spirit. And the minute I start thinking about the Christmas spirit, you start thinking about all the movies that come on the TV. Maybe you have a special radio station you listen to. But my mind went to the novel that Charles Dickens wrote, and A Christmas Carol, back in 1843. And in there you have Scrooge, and he's visited by three ghosts. The Christmas spirit of past, present, and future. And, you know, Christmas, where is our focus on Christmas? Are we looking at past events? Are we only focusing on Christmas as the birth of Jesus? You know, that's just the starting point. It just started there. So if we focus there, it doesn't end there. We don't want to stay focused there. Well, then maybe we look at Christmas of the present. As we gather together with family, are we talking about Jesus? Where's our minds going? Is it the true meaning of Christmas that is present, or are we caught up in all the commercialism, the Santa Claus and all the lights and all that that's going on around us? Where is it kind of taking us? But you know, my mind was taken, okay, that was his first coming, but the further along we get, he's coming again. And that is what I'm looking at today, and what I'd like to take and focus on you. And we'll see if I can kind of take this Christmas story that we've all heard over and over again, and we'll pull it in and see if we can take and put it in a little bit different focus. If you want to bring that picture up real quick, you know, back in Indiana, we have a lot of railroads. And as you stand on the road and it goes all the way out in the distance, you know, we can focus on what's in front of us, but there's so much that's coming down the road. And that's where I would like to take us today, is what's coming. Our sins are behind us. The birth of Jesus is behind us. It just got started. We're here where we are right now. Hopefully everyone that's sitting here has asked Jesus to be part of our life. That's where we're at now. But where are we going in the future? That's where we want to take a look at. So the spirit of Christmas, we might think of love, hope, and peace. And you know, how does the atmosphere change, or why, more importantly, why does the atmosphere change just on Christmas? All of a sudden you have people, they're excited, there's more happiness, they're showing more kindness to the people around them, all of a sudden you're given gifts. Why does it stop just on Christmas? You know, we live in a world where God is continually being removed from our lives, but yet all of a sudden Christmas rolls around and all of a sudden it comes back up. And you know, people don't realize it, but God's still there. The Christmas spirit is still alive and well, and God's still at work. You know, we were praying and stuff, and the thought came to mind, that last grain of sand has not fallen from that hourglass yet. God is still at work, and he's got plenty more to do. Honduras is the perfect example. People are coming to know Christ. He's still at work. But what's going on in your life today? More importantly, what are you going to do tomorrow and the months to come? Are you ready for Christ's return? So the spirit of Christmas is in the air, and it's still alive, like I mentioned. You know, Jesus' birth on that night wasn't the only gift. It wasn't just the gold, frankincense, and myrrh. We were given the gift of love, peace, and hope. And are we going to, ultimately, I'm going to ask you a question at the end. Are you keeping that gift to yourself? You know, the spirit of Christmas is giving, and we're giving gifts out, but you know, the most important, so many people come into Christmas and they get depressed because of things. Maybe there was a loss of a loved one on Christmas. I believe my wife's grandpa died on Christmas Eve. Maybe there's something like that that's there, and all of a sudden Christmas, there's a dark light on Christmas. Or maybe you're focused just on the things that are going on in somebody else's life, and you're saying, why not me? Why can't I experience some of that happiness? And so many people get caught up in the chaos, and all of a sudden they get drugged down. But we have that gift of hope and peace and love that we can take and give to them. And so we're going to look at those few things. Let's first look at the spirit of love. Let's pull up John 3:16. It's a verse we're all familiar with. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Whosoever believes in him, the gift of eternal life, the ultimate gift, the ultimate sacrifice, the ultimate gift of love was given by God. He came down and put himself in a human body. He came in flesh. His only Son. All we have to do is believe. You know, Romans 5:8, but God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So not only did he come and experience what we experience, not only did he come and experience the temptations that we deal with day in and day out, not only did he experience all the things we struggled with, he paid the ultimate sacrifice for us. He loved us while we were yet sinners. We didn't have to be perfected before we were able to come to him. He showed his love to us while we still were flawed and broken. We want to remember that. That gift of love, it's a gift of love that we can pass on to others. Then as we move through the next spirit, the gift of peace. Let's take a look at Luke 2:14. Glory to God in the highest on earth, peace among men with whom he is pleased. So on that night, the angels sang to the shepherds, and he provided that to them because he was pleased with them. He wanted them to take and go to Jesus and give praise and glorify him. You know, on that starry night, the angels sang glory in God in the highest, peace among those he is pleased. Are we actively in a relationship with Jesus Christ in our life? Are we looking and growing and drawing closer to him? He drew us initially, but are we continuing to stay in his presence? Are we continuing to stay in his word and building that relationship? As I was talking to the young adults this morning, and we were talking about where our focus was, the comment came up, well, what about prayer? And absolutely, you know, if we're not spending time talking with God, how can we expect for him to hear what our hearts, though he knows, he wants to hear it from us. He wants us to talk to him and come and abide in his presence in prayer and seek him out. You know, that peace comes from getting to know our Lord and Savior. We want to truly experience him. John 14:27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Do not let your heart be troubled, nor let it be fearful. Peace I leave with you. It's a gift of peace that he's given to us. But as we look back on Christmas, that's something that's already taken place. Peace doesn't come from that. Peace is coming from the things that are yet to come. We know Jesus is going to return for us. He came once already. And as we look, eventually we're going to look at the Magi and we're going to look at the shepherds. For heaven's sakes, the Magi came just because of prophecy, let alone. You have shepherds, the angel came to them. God drew them in. So we're going to look at that. But our peace comes from what is going to come before us. Our peace is not like the peace of the world. The peace of the world, they're looking at people getting along. You know, Jesus doesn't provide peace. There's conflict among the believer and the non-believer. That's not peace. But for those that believe, peace is among us because we know what's coming. We know that the price of our sins has already been paid. We can have peace in knowing what our future holds. Jesus left us with peace. By believing in him, we have peace in what the future holds, just like I said. Let's look at John 16:33. These things I have spoken to you, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage, I have overcome the world. You know, as we go through the book of Job, just like Pastor brought up, we see a man that is in turmoil. He's been beaten down to the nth degree. He's lost his family. His body is covered in sores. But, you know, as we look at Jesus and his life, we know he overcame. And because of that, we can believe. We know what is going to come, and we know that we can overcome. That peace that no matter what's thrown at us, we're going to come out on the top end when it's all said and done. Right now, we may be battered and bruised, but we are going to stand up again, and one day we ultimately stand in his presence, and we will thank him for what he has done for us. No matter what our tribulation, we can believe we will overcome, just as Jesus did. So now, lastly, let's take a look at hope. Romans 4:18. In hope, against hope, he believed, so that he might become a father of many nations, according to that which has been spoken. So shall your descendants be. Our hope against hope, he believed. You know, all that struggle that we go through, we can still have hope no matter what's thrown at us, like I said. We will overcome. Our hope is what has not yet come, but we eagerly await. Our hope does not lie in the things we have seen. So, the spirit of Christmas, you know, one last verse we want to take a look at is Job 19:25. We've been spending time in Job, wanted to kind of pull this in here because it really fits today. Job 19:25-27 here. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last he will take his stand on the earth, even after my skin is destroyed, yet from my flesh I shall see God, whom I myself shall behold, and whom my eyes will see, and not another. My heart faints within me. A man like we talked about, that is battered and bruised beyond degree, yet he knows his Redeemer lives. This is before Jesus has even came, yet he believes his Redeemer lives. He knows, even though the price on the cross hasn't been paid, one day he will lay his eyes on his Savior, his Redeemer. We can have that hope and reassurance as we look back at the Christmas. That's just the starting point, like we said. But we have peace in the presence as we go through turmoil, as we go through Christmas with family members. We can sit down with family and just relax because we know we have that hope of assurance of what's to come. But that brings us to where we ultimately want to kind of look at today. When we look at the shepherds, and we look at the Magi, we can look at Mary, we can look at Joseph. There's all sorts of places we can go with the Christmas story. But we're going to focus in just on the Magi and the shepherds. You know, in our Christian walk here a few months ago, we spent time looking at discipleship. And what amazed me and touched my heart is, and hopefully it was for you guys also, each one of us has a testimony. Each one of us has been affected by Jesus Christ in our life. He has reached out to us and drawn us in. And as we look at the Magi, like we already mentioned, all they had was the prophecy. But they believed. And they traveled many, many miles. We don't know exactly how far. It may have been 500. It was on camels. You know, it had to be nothing like us riding in our cars and the heated seats or the air conditioning in the heat of the summer. It wasn't anything like that. But yet they still believed. They still believed that something was there and they had to see. Are we being stirred to continue forward? Is our hunger for Jesus Christ continuing to draw us that way? Are we willing to make that sacrifice to step out to get to know Christ in our life more? They made that step, though they didn't know what was in front of them. It's interesting to kind of think about, though they were drawn to Jerusalem and then to Bethlehem. You know, so often in our walk we get distracted and something might pull us off path. But the hope is we ultimately come back to where we needed to be. And they found themselves, though later on after his birth, they found themselves exactly where God wanted them. They were drawn by God. They were drawn and they believed. They made that choice to believe. Are we actively making that choice each and every day in our life to believe what we've been told? The Bible is 100% truth. I constantly tell the young adults that. We need to believe the Bible is 100% truth. If we only pull bits and pieces, all of a sudden we're going to be off balance and off kilter and open to things that lead us astray. The Bible is 100% truth. They believed and they traveled and they went. The shepherds are a different story. They are humbly, they're the lowest of lows. They're out there in the fields, possibly sitting on a rock. They didn't have the nice lawn chairs that we have today. They were sitting on a rock. Possibly, you know, it kind of draws me back to the men's retreat. As I went into the woods, I found this rock. It kind of came down and came back up, and I was able to sit down and lay back and kind of look at the stars. I can't help but think if that's what it was like for the shepherds that night. And they're watching over their herd of sheep, and as much as chaos as sheep can kind of bring, and all of a sudden the skies open up, and we hear them sing, "Glory to God in the highest." You know, they had when God drew them, it was something very deep and very something open and heartfelt. One of us may have had a story similar to that, where all of a sudden the gift of the Holy Spirit moves in us in a way we've never experienced before. And all of a sudden, some of us may have the story of the gift of tongues, yet others it may be just a quiet, gentle nudge. And all of a sudden, God draws us in. Are we open to that? God is choosing us to draw us into his love, like we sang about Abba, our Father. You know, that relationship with our Father, that loving relationship with our Father. Are we looking to him as the Father that we love and adore? Each one of these examples take us to different places. Let's take a look at John 6:44 real quick. "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day." We are only drawn by him. He draws us in. It's not us coming to him. He is looking to us to reach out to him. As he reaches to us, are we going to reach out and grab his hand? And as we looked at the examples of the Magi and the shepherds, they responded. They left to go see this child that was born on that night. Let's look at Matthew 2:5-6. "They said to him in Bethlehem of Judea, 'For this is what has been written by the prophets, and you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means last among the leaders of Judah. For out of you shall come forth a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" That last part is Old Testament prophecy. Like we mentioned, that's all they had to rely on. They were relying what was written in front of them. We are blessed to know what has already happened. Yet, now we look for Christ's return. We know the only things we know is like a thief in the night. We know we can look at the atmosphere. We can take the temperature of the people and look around and all of a sudden we're like, it's getting close. It's getting real close. But he has drawn us so we are ready. They had just the old scripture. Are you responding in like manner? Let's take a look at Matthew 2, 10 through 11. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. With great joy. After coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell to the ground and worshipped him. Then opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. As we walk with Jesus Christ, are we in awe of him? Are we giving him all the glory and praise? Are we thanking him for what's going on in our life, even the smallest of things? So often, it's just a blessing to have your family close by. As a kid growing up, my grandma was truly blessed. All four of her kids lived within a four-mile radius. Every single Christmas, it wasn't spent at their homes. They came to grandma's house. And all the grandkids were there, all the aunts and uncles. The uncles went in the living room and watched their football. The women sat around the table and talked. And everybody got to truly experience God's blessing on that day. But they gathered together. Are we looking to take and talk to others about Jesus Christ? Are we really appreciating that blessing that he's given us, even in the smallest things in our life? Is that light in our heart shining? You know, we joked about in the young adults class today how people worry about their appearance. They're dyeing their hair purple and green. But you know, that's not what shows God in our life. That's drawing people to look at us personally. Our attitudes, our reactions, our words that we take and tell, how we respond to people. Do we have a loving ear to take and turn to them? That's how God shines in our life. So let's take a glance at the shepherds. We all know what took place there. We've talked about how they are the lowest of lows and how they're sitting in the fields. Luke 2:15. When the angels had gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds began saying to one another, "Let us go straight to Bethlehem, then and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." They left and went straight there. They didn't sit there and talk about what they had seen. They didn't ask questions. They weren't pondering, "Well, what do you think? What do I think? I don't know what you think." They left. They were excited. They were in awe of what they had just experienced, and they went. They wanted to praise and worship the God who they were told of, this child that was born. Where's that excitement in our heart? We've all talked about how Jesus is part of our life, but is that excitement still in our heart, just as the shepherds went straight out? Is there a desire, a hunger in your hearts to take and go out and tell others about what you're experiencing? You know, just because the birth of Christ was there doesn't mean we can't take and talk to them. We don't, though it starts there like we talked about. There's so much going on in our life in the present, but ultimately we point them in the future. The price has been paid, but this is what's yet to come. They knew what was coming, and it had happened. The fruition of the culmination of the scripture had came, and they went. They went straight there. Luke 2. This is our verses we read earlier, but let's take a look at them again. Luke 2:17-18. When they had seen this, they made known the statement which had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it wondered at the things which were told them by the shepherds. We've all looked at God's word. We've all heard and we've all experienced potentially, the hope is at least we've all experienced the Holy Spirit moving in our life. Are we reaching out to others and telling them what the Holy Spirit's doing? I mean, are we going to hold on to that gift of hope and peace and love and keep it to ourselves? I mean, is it stirring something in us to go out and take and talk to others? Is it alive and well? We talked about the spirit of Christmas being alive and well. Well, is Jesus, is the Holy Spirit alive and well in our hearts? I mean, Are we stagnant? You know, if there's not growth, we're dead. I mean, if there's nothing happening, what's going on? We need to ask ourselves questions. Is the Holy Spirit alive and well in our hearts? And are we moving to take and tell others? You know, we see the other thing we can look at now that we've looked at both the Magi and the shepherds. You have men of men of wealth that potentially were astrologers, men of knowledge. And then you have the lowest of lows, the shepherds. You know, God does not exclude. God calls all people to Him. What are we going to do with it? You look at the Magi and they came. They brought gifts. They praised God. They worshiped Him. But the part we don't see is what happened afterwards. Did they tell others? We don't know. I kind of wonder if they didn't. Otherwise, I would like to think God would have put it in there for an example for us. But men of knowledge, we don't see. But the humblest of humble, the lowly shepherd, you know, and God moved in their lives that night, and they went forth. They went out. It doesn't take all the knowledge to stand up to somebody to take and quote verses and all this stuff. All it takes is to vocalize what you're experiencing. What, when you're experiencing that love, what does it feel like? You know, mankind has a deep desire to feel loved, needed, and appreciated. We just talked about how God has shown us love. Why aren't we showing others that love? We all mankind has that desire to feel loved. And as we show people love, all of a sudden they feel appreciated. Are you reaching out to somebody? If you know somebody's going through a tough time, are you reaching out to them, talking to them, encouraging them, lifting them up? Hey, it's okay. Turn an ear to them. Maybe it's an ear you need to offer. But ultimately, it's those things that will allow others, non-believers, to see God shining in our lives. Are we going to be like the shepherds and go straight forth? Or are we going to take and get excited in the moment and praise God, and we roll in on Sunday, we're praising God, and then we leave, and then it just kind of disappears into the horizon, and we don't know what's going on? What is your life going to hold tonight, tomorrow, or the weeks to come? If God was to come tonight, would it surprise you or catch you off guard? Or are you ready? You know, we joke about our boarding pass already being in our pocket and ready to go. We're all going to be caught up in the sky with Him one day. Are we ready? Or are you going to be caught fumbling, looking for things, and all of a sudden Jesus is up and gone and you're left behind? You know, we want to be found actively doing God's will in our life. The shepherds were drawn in and they instantly went out. It's more than just believing what we see in God's Word. The Magi believed the Scriptures, but did it change their life? They experienced a moment, but did it change their road down the road? They seen the fruition of the Scripture. We talked about believing the Scripture to be 100% truth. You would think after seeing the fruition of the Scripture come to complete truth, you would think that would stir them, and all of a sudden you would see changed people all around them. But we know nothing about the Magi. But as the shepherds went out, we see the reaction recorded in Scripture. It's not an instantaneous, oh, and they're going to join on board. That's not always the case. You know, there's some people it may take you talking to them multiple times. They're not necessarily going to be ready possibly at that moment. It may take you going back multiple times saying, hey, how's it going? Hey, did you ever think about this verse I told you about? You know, Jesus did this in my life this week. He really answered prayer. You know, that gentle nudge. The other comparison that I gave the young adults today is when you're lighting that fire with that fire stick, and it may take multiple strikes before all of a sudden you have a flame. It's not instantly that first spark when you talk to somebody. It may take more than inviting somebody to church. You know, inviting somebody to church is all great, but in today's society, that's become something that's not a preference. You may have to lead them and give them a guidance right there. It's not a pastor's responsibility to tell somebody about Jesus Christ. We're all called to be disciples. And ultimately, that's what we're going to, that's the part I'm ultimately trying to focus in on today is we are all called to be disciples. What are we going to do with it? You know, if we take a look at Matthew 16:24, then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. We talked about the hope as everyone that's sitting here is their desire is to follow Jesus Christ. Do we really know what it means to take up our cross? You know, I was listening to Greg Laurie on the phone the other day, and he talked about, well, some people that may be wearing a crucifix. Some people that may be just signing on the line to be a member of a church. Others may tattoo it on their arm. What is taking up our cross? And you know, the scripture tells us to do it daily. Not just taking it up, daily taking up our cross and going forth. God wants us to talk to others about Jesus Christ and what he's doing, what he's did, what he's going to do. All the aspects in our life, not just what he did today, what he's going to do. You know, if we don't present the gospel to them, will they hear it? If not from us, then who? Where's it going to come from? Are you going to sit on it like we talked about and hide it to yourself and hold it inside? You know, what good is a half-hearted Christian? And as you kind of think about that, it's like an espresso without caffeine or a car without an engine or a race car without an engine, really, when you take and think about our walk with Jesus Christ. There's so many things that we can think about that halfway just doesn't cut it. All of a sudden it becomes, I was talking to my wife about fixing a computer, and the question was asked, well, what are we going to do with it if we don't get it fixed? Well, it becomes a big fancy paperweight. You know, if we're holding, if we own a Bible and we're not opening it up and reading it and telling it to others, just like I joked about that computer being a big fancy paperweight, our Bible becomes nothing else but a paperweight. What are we doing with it? Are we trying to look at God's Word and really take it and utilize it? What's it doing in our lives? What's Jesus, the Holy Spirit, doing in our lives and drawing us out? If we're not listening, what's the point? Are we really taking up our cross? I've always talked about accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior is only step one. Just like the birth of Christ was only step one. That didn't complete the task at hand for him. We need to allow him to be Lord in our life. And when he's Lord of our life, are we showing others how much that we love him? The scripture actually states that we should hate our family because of him. And it's not saying that we should literally hate them. But that's how much we should love God in our life. That's how much we should love what Jesus is doing in our life. In contrast to that, it is like hating them because they're here and God's here. And we, as we raise our hands to him and ask him to take us in, that's that contrast between our relationship with our family compared to what our relationship with God should be. Are we really reaching out to him to accept his love? Let's look at Luke 14, verses 34 through 35. Therefore, salt is good, but if even salt has become tasteless, with what will it be seasoned? It is useless either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear it, let him hear. I asked the young adults this morning, have you ever had food that is bland and tasteless? You know, we are called to be the salt of the earth. But if we've lost our flavor, we're useless. It's not even good for the manure pile. I mean, for heaven's sakes. That should stir something in our hearts. The last thing we'd want. Are we being the salt of the earth? Are we looking out to others and stuff? Are you worthy? The other statement or thing we've heard in the past is, are you worth your weight in salt? Back in those days, salt was priceless to those people. Yet we're called to be the salt of the earth, and that's what God's desire is for us to do while we're present here. Our time is short. We've all potentially seen Pastor's example, the long white rope, yet that little piece of red is all our life tends for. Are we only focused on that little piece? But do we know in our hearts we have the rest of eternity to take and spend with Jesus Christ in our life? And if that stirs in our life, and all of a sudden that salt that we use to flavor our food, that salt that we take and talk to others about, the salt of what Jesus Christ is doing in our life, all of a sudden that flavor draws up and it excites our taste buds, and it should excite others in their life of what God's doing in our life and what God can do in their life. I want what they have. What's special about them? There's nothing special about them. It's what's going on inside them. But yet if we don't tell them that, they're looking at you. I had a young guy that worked for us. When he came in for his interview for the job, he had a green goatee. What was he trying to achieve? Is he trying to draw himself out, make himself stand out? We don't want to stand out because of that in our lives. The color, like I joked about earlier, the color of our hair, the way we look, the way we present ourselves in appearance is not what God desires of us. Are we reaching out to those that are in need? As disciples, we are called to give up our title of our life. As we sell a car, we sign our name on the dotted line and we relinquish and the car goes. Are we relinquishing our title of our life and giving ownership to Jesus Christ? Are we doing what His will is in our life? Or are we still holding on to it and not relinquishing? You know, so we've looked at how God draws us in and how He changes our life. What about the non-believers? What about the new believers? You know, we talked about how everyone has a desire to be loved and appreciated and needed. How is that going to be filled? Is it going to be filled by the world around them? Is it going to be filled by non-believers? Or are you going to affect the people around us? Are you going to draw them in and allow them to see God in our life? I know I'm repeating that a lot, but what are we doing with it? Isaiah 50, verse 4 says, "The Lord God has given me the tongue of disciples, that I may know how to sustain the weary one with a word. He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to listen as disciples." That's exactly what I'm talking about. As disciples, we need to turn an ear for those that need. You know, as we looked at Job, we see he has three friends that come to sit down with him. But they weren't there to listen to him. They were tearing him down. As we sit down with people that are going through a tough time, are we turning an ear to their needs? God will draw people, bring people, probably the better word, to us in hopes that He will use us. You know, we are the hands and feet of the church. Are we useless? Or are we going to be up front trying to show God's love in our life? Matthew 9:37, Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few." Right there is our call. There are many out there. We see it. You know, it's one thing to think and read it. We're seeing it happen in Honduras. We pray for our community. Why not here? The Bible says that the harvest is ready. It may not be quite ready, but are you ready to go out and be a worker? The workers are few, so we all got to go at it as a team effort. Though our church is small, we've seen we can do many mighty things with us. Are we each one ready? Though all of us don't live in Black Canyon City, are we affecting our neighbors? Are we reaching out to our neighbors in our community? Are we continuing to pray for the people around us, for their lives to take and see God shining in our life? God needs workers, for they are few. As disciples, we are to help the weary and listen to those that need an ear. So with that said, this is your bulletin. I ask you now, are you going to hold on to those gifts yet again? Are you going to go out and have that love that Jesus Christ has provided to you stir in your heart enough to where you vocalize it to others? Are you holding on to your past or looking to Christ to return? It's one thing to appreciate the birth of a child, but like we said, that's only the starting point. It's one thing to have God draw us in and accept Him as our Lord and Savior. That's just a starting point. It's a kickstart. It's just a point where things start. If I go back to my drafting days, it's a ray. That's just the starting point. Where's the ray going to end up? Where is that ray going? That light that's in our life, that ray of light that's in our life, that love God has shown us, what are we doing with it? Are we putting something in front of it and stopping it from doing what God intended? The shepherds, as we come back to them, they knew what to do. Do you know what to do? The Magi, who knows? Do we want to be lost in the pages and forgotten? What's God doing in your life? Step forward. I call you now. I have a couple guys I've been talking to, and I've called them out. I said, it's time for you to step up and be a Christian, to have it shine in your life. Are you guys stepping up? Are you being challenged? Do you have an accountability partner that's holding you accountable for your actions? Sometimes we need somebody to stand next to us. And if that's the case, find somebody. We need to be accountable. When God comes, are you going to be found in His will? Let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for coming to this world that we live in, giving Your only begotten Son, Lord, to ultimately be crucified on the cross, Lord. Just another stopping point where the price of our sins was paid in full. The hope is we accept that gift that You've paid, Lord, but stir in our hearts a desire and excitement. Renew that excitement in our hearts, Lord, that it overflows into other people's lives. And may other people see, just as that star shone over Bethlehem, may they see that light shining in our lives, Lord. I just thank You for who You are, Lord of our life. But, you know, most importantly, we know You're coming soon, Lord, and we praise You and thank You when we look for eternity and we are excited. I thank You. We humbly lay this at Your feet in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, everyone.
I don't know what kind of notes you took. I took some, but this is what's one of the things that stuck out and sounded like an oxymoron. I don't know if Chandy meant it to sound like an oxymoron or not. I don't know. When you got saved, when you received Jesus, did it change your road down the road? I didn't make so much sense to me. When you received Jesus Christ, would you say you did that? your road down the road. And I thought of that, you know, looking at the railroad tracks going down into the vanishing point. That's where we want to be. We want to be on the track that Jesus set before us, past the vanishing point. And you know, it just hits my heart that my friend has a church of 100 people who are, they parked off to the side of the rest stop, or they switched out to another track. I don't know where people like that are at, but this serious business of becoming a Christian is just, what a great illustration that was, to be focusing on the advantage of everything ahead of us and staying on the track. Staying in care and all that. I don't know how she thinks. So, but yeah, did it change the road? Your road, down the road. That was just so good. Hey, let's go ahead. You guys are going to be leaving. Let's just, you know, keep praising God. A couple more songs. So let's go ahead and praise God. Please stand before the Lord and let's worship.
Okay. Thank you, Lord, for the word. Your baby boy would someday walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kissed your little baby, you kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding, great I am. Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know? Ooh. The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. Dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that that your baby boy will one day rule the nations. Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding, he is the great I am. The great I am. Mary, did you know?
Have a song that fits this community and where y'all live just perfectly. Out here in the country, there's magic in the air. It's the middle of December, and there's excitement everywhere. Everyone's invited, the celebration's planned. Oh, the gift is just what's in your heart and not what's in your hands. And who's the one we need to thank? And who's this party for? And who's the one responsible for all this peace and joy? And who deserves the credit for the blessings we enjoy? Oh, the preacher said last Sunday it was Joseph and Mary's boy. La 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 la. There were times we didn't think that we'd make it through the year. The baker tried to take our home, but somehow we're still here. I don't know how this world survives all the sorrow and the pain. Oh, it must have been a miracle through his love that's here proclaimed. And who's the one we need to thank? And who's this party for? And who's the one responsible for all this peace and joy? And who deserves the credit for the blessings we enjoy? Well, the preacher said last Sunday it was Joseph and Mary's boy. Oh, the Christ child born in Bethlehem, Jesus Christ our Lord. La 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 la. Everyone's invited, the celebration's planned. Oh, the gift is just what's in your heart and not what's in your hands. And who's the one we need to thank? And who's this party for? And who's the one responsible for all this peace and joy? And who deserves the credit for the blessings we enjoy? Oh, the preacher said last Sunday it was Joseph and Mary's boy. Oh, the Christ child born in Bethlehem, Jesus Christ.
Right. May the Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord be gracious unto you, the Lord lift up his countenance on you, and may he give you peace. May the Holy Spirit fill your heart with the love of Jesus Christ. May it continue to grow all week long until we meet again. God bless you as you go his way this day.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.